first meeting of 2012 in the Veterans Homeland Security Military Affairs Committee. Thank those who are watching the telecast as well. We'll get started with the pledge of allegiance to the tent.
Pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Just a moment of silence for those who have served and are serving abroad and in Ireland. Thank you. I want to welcome everybody to the new year and thank all the senators who are here today. Senator McDowell, Fly, Avella, Grippo, Golden, Stuart, Douglas, Vino, and of course, my great ranger, Senator Dabo. I'd also like to thank, we have a new council, we have our good friend Bob Farley here, who led us through the previous year and provide great leadership and new council under Adam Richardson. So hopefully Adam will be able to come up with me as well as Bob. And of course, Krista Jago is my legislative director. We're honored today to have the governor's nominee, Jerome Hauer, for the commissioner of the Department of Homeland Security and Emergency Services. Mr. Hauer is the chief executive officer of the Hauer Group, a consulting firm that provides customized emergency management solutions to public and private clients around the world. For nearly 35 years, Mr. Hauer has served our country as an accomplished and committed Homeland Security and public health expert. Jerry has served two presidents, including President Clinton and President George W. Bush. He's also served two governors, including Governor Pataki and Governor Bond of Indiana. As a distinguished and highly experienced Homeland Security expert, Mr. Hauer has established valuable relationships with the federal government, as well as in the private sector. Senator Palucci, good to have you. As noted by his tenure at IBM and Kroll Associates. On May 5th, 2002, Mr. Hauer was appointed by the Department of Homeland Security Secretary Tommy G. Thompson to be the acting Assistant Secretary for the Office of Public Health and Emergency Preparedness within the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. In this role, Jerry was responsible for coordinating the country's medical and public health preparedness in response to emergencies, including all acts of biological, chemical, and nuclear terrorism. He's an accomplished academic scholar and the author of 40 publications, which I truly appreciate not having been able to finish my thesis for my master's in about 7 years now. Jerry earned a bachelor's degree from New York University and a master's degree in hygiene and public health from Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, Maryland. He's also received numerous awards, including the Distinguished Fire and Safety Director's Man of the Year Award and the New York State Conspicuous Service Medal, which is the highest award given to a civilian by a government deputy. You know, just from my heart, having gotten to know Mr. Hauer, I think that it goes without saying that the government always has proven the ability to put the exact right person in the exact right spot. And I think that this specific nomination is at the top of that list. And in working with law enforcement and first responder community overall, it's very rare to be in any community of any type and hear only good things about this person. I have heard nothing but good things about the accomplishments and the leadership of you, Jerry. And we were just recently met with law enforcement and a group of first responders all throughout New York State and the accolades from rank and file, who literally dragged hose with you up a hill, as well as at the highest levels. Accomplishments and salutations was truly amazing and very impressive. So it's an honor to be with you, and I look forward to working with you. So without further ado, I'd like to take a motion to have the nomination of Jerome Hauer for Commissioner of the Department of Homeland Security and Emergency Services. Can I have a motion to second the nomination? Thank you. Second? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
I would like to ask some questions.
Yeah.
Okay. Certainly, I want to congratulate you on your wonderful commitment to our city, our state, our country. I represent the Saratoga County, Prince County, the North Country. Communications has been a problem in some of the other states' communities. The difficulty of cell phones, or the difficulty of mountains and radio transmission, or the cost factor to provide that communications. I recognize that there's less people, that that's the population, so it's less than the metropolitan area. But some of these areas are kind of significant areas, the Canadian border, things like that. This has been an ongoing problem with communications in our more rural estate areas. I know that's a mission in the past. Do you have some thoughts on that? I'm concerned about if there's a cost factor involved, some local communities may not be able to do it. If there's any kind of regional representation that we could be hoping to retrieve office with in these remote areas, that would be helpful.
Very good question. Excuse me. One of the first things I did when I came on board was look at our ability to communicate statewide. I called my Connell people in to try and understand where the dead zones were. And I don't care about the density. The density shouldn't be an issue. It's more a matter of people need to be able to communicate. And one of the things we're moving forward on is not just interoperability, but the ability to communicate statewide. We're meeting with Verizon because Verizon right now has the best coverage statewide. We're going to be asking them to put in more towers, more sites, more backup, because I'm frustrated by the fact that when I'm sitting in the office in New York City, I cannot talk to anyone else in the state because of our lack of coverage in some areas. So we are addressing that, and I will have answers for you soon.
I appreciate that. You know, the remoteness of some of these areas endangers the population.
Absolutely.
I think we're all very supportive of protecting our community, and some of these things could be dangerous to the local population that are taking advantage of the technologies available. And it's also dangerous to anybody entering, you know, illegally our country, especially from the Canadian border aspect over here. We just don't have communications. And that is a real fear in upstate New York. Now, certainly we understand that historically, probably now or never, we got to be diligent as far as attacking the metropolitan university area. That's already been attacked once. Some of these people may be coming through our own borders, going through our communities. And at the same time, just the everyday living aspect of those folks out there, they need that. And what they don't need is any cost pushed back to them, because these are roles that they need.
I couldn't agree with you more.
Thank you.
If I can follow up on that, first of all, Mr. Power, thank you for your service, and you have quite an impressive resume, and we're fortunate to have you join the state government again. Thank you. To follow up on Senator McDonald's issues on interoperable communication, do you envision, as you take this approach, and you did indicate that this will now begin to take your attention, and you will develop and explain to us how you're going to solve the issues moving forward. Do you envision, though, that you would include regional representation in any discourse and allow for some public input too in that process?
Absolutely. I've already met with the statewide dispatchers, the public safety answering point representatives. I met with them about 6 weeks ago. I think it's critical that they have input in everything we're doing on communications, because communications is local. We need to have statewide capability, but we need to have good local communications as well. And we can't afford to have the dead spots. We can't afford to have the inability for departments not to be able to talk with one another.
Do you envision that this is something you're going to do yourself, or maybe in a team perspective, but you yourself will be involved in looking at this issue and addressing it?
As my staff has gotten to learn, I'm very techie. I like getting into the weeds on communications, because without adequate communications, response fails. And the ability to manage disasters fails. So I will be overseeing some of it personally. I've got some great technical people, both in the Office of Interoperable communications in our technical shop, and I will be shepherding this as it goes forward, because I want to be able to move throughout the state and talk to anybody and anybody that I need to around the state, including talking back to my office.
Do you anticipate that this may require additional funding at some point in time, too?
With the issue? With the wireless surcharge money that we're already using, I think there is adequate funding right now to get done what we need to do. One of the requirements I put on the interoperable grant money is all radios purchased have to have two things: federal interoperable channels and state interoperable channels. That way, there's a seamless transition around the state on these kinds of frequencies during major incidents.
The other aspect on wireless financing, you know, many of us as members are concerned that some of that money is supposed to be shared with the local governments because they're experiencing issues too, is not being put to that use. So I would ask that we re-examine that and try to honor that commitment that was made under the original intent of legislation, so that all that money is just put here to stay at coffers. Would you look at that?
We did get the grants out at the end of last year. We are getting the money prepared for this year's grants, but I would be happy to talk with you more, and I will follow up with them.
Sure, it's beyond the grants, it's actually the allocation, but we can follow up on
that.
One last thing, Mr. Chairman, I thank you for the indulgence here. The chair is going to visit the Homeland Security Training Center, which is in my district.
Sure. Yeah.
And I would hope that we could have you visit also, and that you would sustain that commitment, hopefully enhance it, because I believe that training is so important and significant as you develop policies to protect the state and our nation.
I want to see the training facility become the nation's preeminent facility. As you know, the governor's made a commitment to it. The legislature has made a commitment to it. I know you and the senator will be out there tomorrow. Unfortunately, I could not, but I will be there soon. It is moving forward. Jim Clark, who's overseeing that, is keeping me apprised of everything going on there. I want to make sure that when we hire a director, we do a nationwide search to get the best possible person, to have the best possible program, so that becomes the facility for first responders in the state and in the nation.
And thank you for your service, and look forward to working with you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It's very good to see you again. Thank you for being here. Congratulations on your appointment. Obviously, you were part of that 9/11 when the tower went down. Of course, we talked about Verizon, but we couldn't use radios or telephones because there weren't enough cell towers that were taken out in the actual explosion at the World Trade Center. Are we going to be able to counter them or anybody else taking out cell towers that would be make your communications
in our room? That's always a concern. The infrastructure for communications is a target, and it's one we're concerned about. With any communications, what I look for is redundancy, and that's what we need to do as we plan statewide. So we need a basic system, and we need a backup system. And whether that backup system is microwave, which I'm not a big fan of, or satellite, which makes more sense, we do need to have that capability.
I'm not going to ask you to chime in on this because it's locality, that being the city of New York, but there's been some confusion as to the radio systems being used in the city. One system that's in the train stations, one system that's up on the streets with the police offices, one system with Port Authority, each one with their own systems, the fire department, EMS, and now we're just starting to get some coordination, but not complete coordination. How does that affect your mission as a state threat?
I've been talking with both police, fire, and OEM. I was down there for a week, met with all the departments, I'm going to go down and see Ray Kelly again. I've known Ray for many years. Kelly's a great guy, and Ray and I got to know Ray when he was a one-star chief at SOD, so we go way back. And as you all know, my chief of staff, Jerry McCarty, Ray was his platoon leader in Vietnam. So Jerry and Ray go back to Vietnam days, so we have a good relationship. And we are looking at those issues, and I can get back to you. But I do know that OEM and the city are trying to resolve. The fire department is operating the UHF, getting off VHF. So there, it will be easier for them to talk on a common frequency.
Thank you. We have a military installation, Fort Hamilton military installation in Brooklyn, New York. And that became very vital when 9/11 struck. And of course, even the ice storms and the storms upstate New York, we had a rallying point for National Guard reservists and to be able to send these troops out into the field and where they were necessary. And it was very effective. What they're trying to do right now, I believe, towards the federal government, moving some federal agencies and state agencies into the Fort Hamilton Army base, taking them out of the city of New York. Are you aware of that? Can we get some support for you to try to help us have that facility be a response to an emergency that would be in the tri-state area, but specifically that of New York State?
I was not aware they're moving more. I do know that they have moved some military operations. I do know of one intelligence agency that's moved there, and I do know of some others that have moved there. I will follow up on it and come back to you.
We'd like that further communication. And last but not least, I mean, I'm sure you're abreast of it, but I'd like to get an update on it and where we are going as a state, and that's cross border with Canada and with the federal ID chip, and how are we making it easier for people that should have access to that chip, and obviously making it more difficult for those to cross those borders illegally.
All right. I will get back to you on both of those.
Thank you very much.
I will set up some time to come and brief you.
Thank you. And again, congratulations, and my regards to you as you said.
Yeah, I will. Thank you.
First, Mr. Howard, I want to congratulate you. I want to congratulate our governor. You're certainly the most qualified appointment to this position that was created. One of the things that I have been interested in over the years is water security. I wrote a law that I think took place in 2002, which required every water system in the state of New York to do a vulnerability assessment, as well as figure out a plan what to do in case our water supply comes under attack. I'm not sure of the compliance, especially the city DEP. Is that something that we should work on as we still can? And I guess maybe we're going back now about 8 years. Is there any new plan or something that we can look at as far as ensuring that our water supply?
I looked at the water supply when I worked for the mayor. He asked me to come up and take a look at security for our reservoirs. And I made some recommendations. There are different vulnerabilities. I don't want to get into a lot now, but I'd be happy to talk with you one-on-one. But I know DEC and DEP, particularly DEP, because they own the reservoir, take security very seriously. I have not met with the commissioner yet, but that's one of the things I will be doing. The good news about our water supply is because of the volume used every day, contaminating the water supply is very difficult. You know, we used to have a saying, dilution is the solution, and it will take enormous amounts to contaminate the reservoirs. Downstream, it becomes a big problem. But that's something I did look at in the past, and I do plan on looking at it again.
Any further questions?
Move the nomination.
Would you like to speak, say a few words?
No, but Senator, it's an honor for me to be here with you all today. Senator, it's been great getting to know you, and your leadership on this committee. I've been very grateful for what you've done. I look forward to working with all of you, and whatever I can do, I am always available. I don't want to give you my numbers here in public, but my staff will give you my numbers. My cell is always on 24 hours a day. My wife loves that, but you're always welcome to use it. And I'm one of those people that I don't stand on ceremony, so when you need something, call me. That's the way I do business, and I pay personal attention to it.
Thank you, sir. So we have a nomination from Senator Golden. We have a second. Second, Senator Lucci. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Congratulations, Commissioner.
Thank you.
We have an active agenda here. It's 10 bills. We'll be really quick. Okay, we'll get started. Our first bill is 1431 by Senator Homeland.
An act to amend military law in relation to the revocation of a flag of the United States to a person designated to dispose of the remains of certain members of the organized militia.
Okay. Do I have a motion to move the bill? Any questions?
Yeah.
Move the bill. Second? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Bill supported. 1504 by Senator Larkin.
An act to amend the general business law in relation to the unauthorized sale of veterans' commemorative property that took place in the cemetery and the unauthorized sale of cemetery markers and flags.
Any questions or comments?
No.
Good. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Opposed? Bill report. 2423. It's a bill of mine for service disabled veterans, small businesses. Any questions on that?
Motion.
We'll move up. Very good. Second.
Second.
Support.
Reach.
Vote. Okay. In devices. 3894 by my favorite senator, Senator Golden.
An act to amend the military law in relation to enacting the New York City Health and Hospitals Corporation Military Pay Act.
Okay. Any questions, comments? Second?
Second.
Okay. We're reporting. 3956.
An act to amend military law in relation to providing.
Okay. Second.
Absolutely.
4262 by Senator Zell.
An act to amend the civil service law in relation to veterans and competitive civil service program.
Second. Good.
Okay. Are you referring to the Civil Service Committee? Or an Civil Service Law?
It's reported.
Just reported. I think it should be routed to the appropriate committee. I'm going to vote no on this bill at this time. I think there's more discussion. At some point, we continue to add legacy credits on top of legacy credits. We examine cell phones and values. So I would actually request that we move this bill to the Civil Service Committee so we can have a bigger discussion about what the appropriate number of extra credit points are for our veterans.
Okay. I'm sure Senator Zell would be happy to take that input. Work together? Okay. So, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Bill reported. 5066 by Senator Fischella.
That creates a course of instruction and training of providers.
Okay. Any questions or comments on that? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Now the bill is going to finance. And Senator Ritchie, 5231.
An act to amend real property tax law in relation to establishing an exemption for reservists.
Move the bill. Any questions or comments on that?
I just have a question. Would that be just for the period of time that they were reservists? The exemption, though. It would be in perpetuity?
Okay. They would put them on an equal status.
further questions, Councilor Adams? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Bill's reported to finance, 5271.
An act to amend the penal law in relation to soliciting or providing support for an act of terrorism.
Move the bill.
Second.
Any questions, Councilor Adams? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Bill's reported. 5381. If I can just talk quick about this 531, this is the state veteran cemetery bill. We passed it last year, I think, twice. We have a good number of sponsors in both houses. This bill got held up in the assembly. Right now, there's 30 states to take advantage of. We're losing federal funding. We have World War II vets and other vets dying every day without access to a veteran cemetery.
Move the bill.
Okay.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, reported finance. Thanks so much, God bless.
Thank you.